So again, welcome everyone. Wow, so the recording is on. So as I was saying, today's session, the topic, right, in double quotes, the so-called topic for today's session will be, we take up one application or two applications, for example. One of you already has your application, Yogasmita, we can discuss that. And if anyone else has, say, Bhuvan, I not yet submitted my application, I have some questions before I click submit. We can also discuss that. And after discussing these applications, we will also have a regular question and answer session on any topic. Please bring in any topic you want. We can discuss that. It could be from the examination on the application. It could be on anything in knowledge area. Free, actually, it's open house basically, where you can bring in any damn question on your PMP examination. We can discuss. So that's the second part. So is there anyone other than Yogasmita who has basically their applications for discussion, or your guys have already submitted your applications and you're just waiting to write the examination?
I think no one is there.
No one? All right.
No one's answering it.
Okay, then we can do anyway. Discussing one sample thing will also enable, because we will go through the entire application process. So basically, we'll go to the entire application, what Yogasmita has, and then questions are common. Hey, what should I write? How should I write? And in fact, for your information, for all your information, PMP. Sorry, PMI changed its application pattern. I think it's for all examinations, not just PMP. Where in the past you had to split your exam, your experience into the five process areas: initiating, planning, executing, monitoring, controlling, and closing, and then had to explain what you did in each of the areas. Now the application is more how to say, simple. It's simpler one, because where you have to, of course, describe it in some characters, 500 characters or 1500 characters or whatever it is, and that's it. And you don't have to have this deep split into the five process groups and explain in each process group what you did. So we will go through this one application that will basically answer the questions from everyone who has a question on how this thing. But if you say, sorry, Bhuvan, I'm not interested in this because I've already submitted my application, I just have to schedule my exam, or I have to just write the exam, I'm not interested, I would also tell you to be patient. Once we finish discussing this, the house is open for question and answers on any topic of PMP. So with that, Yogasmita, can you share your screen and then we can go ahead with your questions?
Yeah, I'm trying to do that first time. It's on the mobile, so let me try. Now, how do I?
Yeah, you are presenting. Yes, you're able to see your.
But what do you see?
We are seeing your screen, different screen, audible, and all those things.
Okay, I think it should. Yeah, this was the one which I sent to you.
Could you expand it, please?
Yeah, so what I did was, I cannot take export a copy of that. Yeah. I told you that it has to be online, and that was also my question in the last session.
If someone, you are telling me you are not able to download it as a PDF? You sent me?
No, I couldn't do that.
Okay. Okay.
I couldn't do that, and someone also in the session last time also said that we cannot do that as well. So I took bits and pieces of every section and then I put it in a Word document. So it almost looks the same. There's no difference here. Yeah.
Okay. So you took screenshots and a lot. Yeah.
Of course, I can be a professional. I'll go through each of them. Yeah. And then here the description, and then the address and identification and so on.
Beautiful. So what we can do is, maybe you can go to the very first screen that you get when you log into your application. So for the benefit of everyone here, we would go through this section by section. Of course, the personal details and all those things, of course, we will not discuss too much in the thing. If there are any tips, I can give you how to write your personal details, but mostly we'll concentrate on writing your experience in this session.
Yeah. But I would want to review through this, might be even if it is for a very small time, just to make
sure. We can do that. We will do that. Yeah. Because there are some tips I have seen in the past also. People, they're not able to write even the personal information properly. Sometimes, rarest of occasions, we have got applications being audited because there were suspicions on, say, your academic education or your certificate hours or something like that. So, beautiful.
So, this is one thing. Academic education, I think at the highest level of education is what it asks. So, bachelor's degree, country of institution, all these are drop-in, so there is nothing different here. Then name of institution I had to type in. I wrote this. Field of study was engineering. This was also automatically, I think, a pull down. Then years attended from to from and to. Okay, so this I did. Then the professional education here. The I had a doubt whether it is it from the 35 PDUs what we get. Is this the same? What they are asking here. So enter your professional education courses related to this certification starting with the most recent.
It's not just the contact hours. For example, they say even if you have done, say, an MBA and one of your subjects in your MBA, right, was on project management or related to project management. Be careful, not operations management, but any topic. Okay, fine, you had operations management itself as a course for one semester. Say over a period of 3 or 4 months, every week one credit or something like that. Imagine you took a 10 credit course, 30 credit course, they call it, right? It could be part of your BTech, MTech, MS, PhD or MBA or anything. A PhD, sorry, it's a slip of the tongue.
Okay,
it could not be. So if you have this, so you have to pick and choose those credits where project management was discussed. Imagine you are having, say, logistics or operations management. It is a, say, 30 credit course. See, 30 hours it is. But if 1 or 2 hours of those was you spent on discussing project management, for example, you can claim that as part of your professional education.
Okay. But that is for all these topics, I think you are intending to say, where we did not have this straightaway training from simple.
Exactly. This is information to everyone. See, the 35 the 35 contact hours, what they claim, it need not be 35 hours of PMP training. That's a misconception everyone has. Many people say, hey, Bhuvan, I've not attended my chapter or PMI some chapter or say a private REP, registered education provider. They provide the training, but you know what? The training is not at all. I'm undergoing, but I have to finish the exam application now.
Whenever
you have these things, I always tell them only one thing. You cannot write a PMP examination unless you have work experience. Work experience basically means you are working in a company. And when you are working in any company, be it a small startup with only 4 or 5 people, or be it in a super big organization like Apple or Amazon, for example, or all those, doesn't matter. You will always have undergone some stupid training here and there. 1 hour training here, 1 hour training on quality management, 1 hour training on how to, for example, plan your projects using some tool, anything. You can actually pick and choose these trainings. And then, because believe me, I have applied for 4 PMI certifications. 3 of them I have cleared. The 4th one I am going to write, ACP examination. Never. In fact, for none of these 4 PMI certifications, I ever gave training. The PMP or ACP or any of these trainings as contact hours. Of course, ACP, I attended a training from PMI Chennai chapter, but I had already applied my 1 year period, already started 2 months before I attended the training. So even there, I did not give any training as this thing. What I did was, in my own organization, say Bosch or earlier in JG, when I was working, whatever trainings I attended, bits and pieces, sometimes simply learn modules, you will get those bits and pieces, not directly PMP, anything that you can show as project management. What are those things you can show as project management? Anything. See, PMP has 10 knowledge areas, right? All the way from integration, say scope, schedule, cost, all the way up to stakeholder management. Try to see what trainings you have had in your organization, either as part of your job or outside the scope of your job. You yourself willingly joined some Udemy or Coursera or Simply Learn, any of those 1 hour modules, 2 hour modules. You can show them. PMI will not reject your application because it's not a PMP training you underwent. It may have some doubts about, hey, this course from Udemy, it says photography, learn photography in 40 hours. And you're given that. I'm giving a very wild example. Photography, learn photography in 40 hours. So why are you giving this as a project? That cannot be a project management training. But imagine you attend a Udemy course. Udemy has all dime a dozen, right? So many courses it has. All 99 rupee courses, 199 rupee courses, almost always it's going out of sale. Courses, right? Going out of business courses. So you have lots of free and cheap courses. Be very careful, because the probability of your application getting audited or picked for an audit increases with the kind of course you list. In fact, if you show your courses coming from a reputed institution, be it your own company or be it a registered REP, right? That's an REP, a private REP or a chapter, the chance of your application being audited is less. Though they say arbitrary, it's not like profiling. They believe that some sections of the society, some countries, there is a huge case of fraudulent practice evidence. No, it's not like that. Of course, it's also there. But most of the time, it's arbitrary based on some high-level evaluation. So it's neither on one extreme, it's not random. On the other extreme, it's also not, how to say, very targeted. So basically, what are the things that will trigger an audit of your application? For example, your institute, your education, high-level education, it's not the standard engineering or anything. It's some strange thing you put. For example, see, even people who do a three-year BSc course, you need basically a four-year course, right? 12 plus 4 or something like that. So if they suspect the kind of education you had, probably it could be in a community college or something where it's part-time or something like that, there's a chance that the number of hours of education or number of years of education is not probably fitting with the requirements of the PMP exam, right? Then they may choose your application for audit. Or your professional experience, you're claiming that you finished your, bachelor's or master's, whatever education, with no work experience within the last 3 years. That is a red flag. Probably that may ring a bell, and they say, if you never had a work experience till 3 years back or less than 3 years back, how did you accumulate 4,500 hours of experience? So such red flags, blatant flagrant red flags under something, right? Those they can basically choose. Such things. So they do have a high-level review and everything in which they choose. So whenever you send an application, you guys also had asked, how long does PMI take to review my application? PMI claims it should be 5 working days or 5 days, 5 calendar days, I believe. So many times you have coupon codes and everything from PMI. You have deadlines before which you have to apply to avail this code. So please actually don't keep it at the last moment, because people say, hey, Bhuvan, you know what? In 5 days, my coupon code is expiring. When yesterday only I sent my application, and PMI says five calendar days. There's a chance on the last day the coupon expires, right? Only they will approve my app, or they will come back with a review. What if after reviewing they say that correction, this correction? That is a review, actually. The 5-day review, basically, the moment you submit your application, basically tells you whether you have structured your application correctly or not. Most of the time, imagine if they don't accept your application, they will not reject it after this 5-day review. They will say, can you rephrase your experience in some way? So this session today is basically to help you to ensure that after 5 days it comes back with all clear, not that you waste more time. So, and then people say, Bhuvan, if there are corrections, again I send it back to them, again at least 2 or 3 days I would lose my coupon code. So that's why we tell people to have some review of it upfront before you even submit your application. So
what is that coupon code for Bhuvan?
Many times PMI has, usually see, if you register for this for the examination before this date, you get $150 off. I got my ACP application like that. In fact, my PBA, professional business analysis certification in PMI, I got a $150 coupon code. Usually at least 2 of these examinations I registered at that time because there was a coupon code available. Some companies like Bosch, till recently they had an agreement tie up with PMI India that people working in the company will get a reduction, provided they apply for the examination by this time. So these are the things. So make sure your application is properly written. It does not raise any red flags. That takes the worst case scenario, right? See, audit is different from this review. After this 5 days review, basically they will give you corrections and everything. And if you submit, normally it should be through. Audit comes when you submit the application, they say yes. You will get 1 out of 2 mails. Congratulations, you pay the exam fees, or hey, your application has been selected for audit. Only then your application goes for an audit. Audit is not a scary thing. If you are not lied anything in your application, you don't have to worry. One thing I repeatedly tell, so for some of you, it may already be known and it may be boring to you. I think that reference system is already removed, right? You don't have to give the references anymore in the old setup.
No. I did not see any such.
Exactly. In the old application, you had to name people for each of your application.
I recall few of them used my names for that, and they always used to ask.
Exactly.
Now I remember. Yeah.
Be careful. In the new system, they have removed the references at this stage, but. If your application gets selected for audit, you'll have to probably go same, get your things, say, notified, notarized or not notarized, get your applications validated by some references. So even if today in your application you're not giving these references, speak to some people who can in the future potentially vouch for your application. Speak to them, show to them that this is what you're going to give, and tell them very clearly you're not naming them today, but if and when your application goes for an audit, you're going to basically come back to them for the sealed envelope. So these are some practices how you can accelerate the acceptance of your PMP application. But we are now in September, in the middle of September, almost close to 15th of September, and if you're planning to write the examination before the exam pattern changes by December end, you already should be at the, that is why today for all others who say, hey Bhuvan, sorry, we are sitting in this session and our application is already through, we don't need this thing, please pardon me. Today we chose this topic because if even by this week, middle of September, you are not yet filed your application for PMP, guys, I'm telling you, you're very late. Please, you're very late to write the examination by December. If you have already done a course, this is why I'm telling you. So if you have already taken the 35 hour contact hours PMP certification, either from a chapter of PMI or from an REP or from other REP or something, private REP, you've taken, then you sincerely attended that, you've taken some of the mock examinations the REP has given you, and basically you've got a decent. I think last week I was speaking to someone, who was it? Rachel, I think. Right? I don't know if she's in the call today. She's not there. So I was basically speaking to her, and during which I explained to her, in fact, I explained to her also how to prepare. In fact, if anyone of you are interested, I, with her permission, I made a recording of that call on Zoom. So do you think actually I should share that also on YouTube, if you are willing? I have a permission and I record the session. Do you think it will be useful if you can share that? Because in that call, I discussed with her. See, that exam tracker I sent you guys, right? Some of you thank me. Thank you. Welcome. You're welcome. In fact, I thank you actually for this opportunity so where I could make this such a tracker. You know, that tracker I have been having for many years, but I revamped it and made a fresh tracker after that call with her. So I sent all of you. So if you are interested, I will share that also on YouTube on the channel PM Ritha. I will share that link with you, because there I have given her. So basically, the person was not completely motivated. She felt, hey, long back I did the PMP. This is true for many of us. You know what? I did my PMP contact hour course many months back. I was the topper in the class. Basically, everyone said, hey, if you do not clear the exam, nobody else can. Such a high josh I had at that time. But I have not written the exam now. Now all the josh is gone. And sorry, actually, now I have gone to the other end. If there was not so much hype, it would have been okay. But it was hyped so much, and I was lots of expectations on my shoulders from my batchmate, from my cohort, from my team members, from everyone. Now I have not written the examination. Now the expectations are high. If I write the examination, there's a chance I may fail. I am demotivated. So that session, about half an hour, 45 minutes or 1 hour, I basically spoke to her, motivating her, telling her how exactly you can prepare for your examination if there are 3 months or 2 months or 1 month left. So that's how the tracker also I revamped. So if you're interested, I will share that session on YouTube, and you can include that. And the gist of that session basically is, I know we are reviewing your application, but this is not just saying yes or no to some questions in the application. It's also about preparing for the examination. And I felt, this being the middle of September, this is probably the last occasion when any motivation, such motivational talk will be useful to people, exam application and everything. So first thing I tell people is, PMP is just another bloody examination. That's it. The only thing scary about PMP examination is the fact you have to sit for 4 hours physically and mentally. The physical, mental stress, the physical and mental stamina you need to sit for 4 hours. That's the thing. Nothing else. So you please, whenever you're doing a mock, my recommendation is You don't take up some stupid cheap free mock on our WhatsApp group. I shared to you a couple of recommendations, right? So take up the mock from PMP, PM Pripcast by, what was that guy's name? Fishner, Cornelius Fishner. So the 90-day trial or something, you can pick that. Because see, At this stage, when you have about 3 months or less left for the examination, your target should be to take such a mock that simulates the real examination, the 4-hour mental and physical stress, not just on Motley collection. You know what? Go to Udemy. You know how many mock exams are there? Cheap, 199 rupees, 200 rupees. Those people are actually earning huge bucks. They are putting some stupid collection of PMP questions. They are picking up from different sources, and there is no copyright also, right? So they pick and choose lots of questions and they make bundles. So all you need to make a bundle is 200 questions, right? And then like that, they collect some 2000 questions, 10 bundles, and they put each bundle 200 rupees. Imagine. Some desperate people like us who are at the last moment now writing for the examination. One moment. Somebody had put some chat messages also. Yes. Okay. It was me. Also, yeah. So, these people, we desperately buy at the last moment. The danger about this mock examination is they're not mocks. Question banks are different. Mocks are different. Question bank means you pick and choose questions from different knowledge areas, different modules of PMP examination to test your knowledge, where you are good at, what you need to concentrate, what kind of questions will come from which knowledge area. For those things, you can use the question banks. See, anything that collects 200 questions in a batch is not a mock examination. Please. If you don't take away anything else from today's 1 hour or 1.5 hours, please take away at least this one learning from today's session. Any collection of 200 questions is not a mock. A mock examination should, in double quotes, simulate the real exam condition. What do you mean by simulating? Just give me a moment. I'll just take some water. Sorry. So, a mock, basically what it simulates is a couple of things. Of course, it makes you sit for 4 hours to simulate the physical and mental stress. But more importantly, it simulates the exam question distribution. You remember the PMP exam content outline? If you don't, please go through PMI portal, go to the PMI portal or from Google also, you can get the so-called PMP exam content outline. The PMP examination is not based on PMBOK. Let me demystify that for you. PMP exam is not based on PMBOK. PMP exam is based on the PMP exam content outline. Take the latest exam content outline. I think it came 2019 also. Something, I don't remember. The latest exam content outline. If you see, there's a distribution of questions. Initiation, planning, executing, monitoring, controlling, and closing. And this is exactly that's going to change in January. Rather than distributing the exams across these 5 process groups, they'll distribute across people's processes and the business. So now, a real mock examination should simulate the distribution of questions from these areas and the difficulty level also. Most people, they get pleasure trying some very difficult mock examination. That is warning two. The second warning is, do not go for any mock exam that claims to make it so tough for you, which claims in double quotes, right? That gives you, confidence to pass the examination. The tougher the mock is, the lesser confidence you will get in clearing the examination. There is something called over-preparation. Even today I was talking to someone, I was telling them over-preparation. Do not over-prepare. Some of you would have seen the movie Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. In that, right, there, you see that big button, do not panic or don't panic. So like that, you can write this in big letters and put a poster at your study desk. Do not over-prepare. There is something called over-preparation. There are many people who come to me repeatedly and say, hey, Bhuvan, this question raises such questions I have been facing. Every day I see a different question in a mock examination, my motivation goes down. Yes, exactly. So what can I do, Bhuvan? Stop bloody taking those questions. Because today I'll show you only one example. Can I quickly show my screen?
Can I share my screen? Yeah.
One moment. I need your permission to. You have to stop presenting, Yogasmita. Just a minute.
Let me check.
I'll show you one sample question. I believe me and. when that question was asked, I straight away said, sorry, actually, such things will not happen in a real PMP examination. So you should be shortly able to see my screen.
So I hope you're able to
see the screen, right?
Anyone?
Yeah. Okay. Can you say this question here? The program is one of the business, blah, blah, blah. First of all, this question is too long.
Yes,
there will be long questions in the PMP examination.
But? Not very long questions.
Sometimes long questions because there is so much of extraneous information, distractors,
red herrings.
That'll be just to divert. But not so long. You're not being tested. This is not a case study in your business school. Not only that, this question is so long. See the actual question. Can you please come up with a 30 days and 90 days action plan? Keeping your competencies, blah, 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 blah. Please do state measure of success. Sorry, this is not a PMP question.
But there are people who go through such things.
So basically, I was asked, will this be a colleague shared this case study? Well, I really don't know what case study from where they are selecting. The questions come. So this is my answer. Long questions sometimes as distractors. But the actual question regarding creating an action plan, state something, blah, 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 do not fall into a regular PMP exam pattern. So this is basically the truth. So you can share your screen again, Yogesh Mehta. So now, 1 minute. You can share your screen again. So please remember, don't over prepare. And that's what I'm telling you. Once you've done some sort of standard training from a PMI chapter or from any REP, you are already 70% ready for the examination, because the trainings tell you what is the deal about PMP. They de-panic you. Ideally, the sessions, any training session should be to de-panic you. There are some people who conduct trainings just to show you the carry. Ah, beautiful. Now you're able to see the full screen bigger. That's beautiful. I think you opened on a...
No, I just made a landscape.
I thought so. No issues. Beautiful. So, exactly. The trainings should be to de-panic you. And once you've done this training, you're 70% ready for the examination. All you have to do is to take one mock examination, real simulation, to do two things. One, are you physically and mentally having the stamina, or what is the gap in your physical and mental stamina to take a 4-hour examination? Number one. Number two, to see which areas you are really bad at, which areas you suck at.
Which areas you are good at. That's all.
Once you have got this, straight away I gave a plan. I will not discuss this today in today's session. I will share that recording on Zoom. I'll share that on YouTube. You can watch that. So in that video or audio, basically, I have basically said, after taking this so-called mock exam zero, where you evaluate your stamina plus your weak areas and strong areas, you have a study plan, the duration of each module being the unit. It depends on the time you have from today till the exam date. It could be 3 months, 2 months, 1 month. So it depends. And so that is why I sent you that exam tracker I shared with you on the WhatsApp group, right? I shared with you because there I have put a duration column. From today till your exam date, how many days are there, that you divide by the number of modules, that gives you a time duration for each module. And if it is, say, 1 month, you will have 1.5 days for each module. If you have 2 months, 3 days. If you have 3 months, you have, say, basically, 5 days or roughly something, 1 week for each module. That is how you can actually plan. And once you enter the duration for each module, automatically the schedule will come to you. So this is basically the background of how to prepare for an examination with whatever time is left. And the closer to your examination, your preparedness at which you start is really high. So you don't have to panic. And lesser time you have for your examination, the lesser and lesser bullshit that you need to take. Do not take too many mock examinations ever. Do not take cheap or free mock examinations that just make money, right, by collecting questions from everywhere and then putting. Some people are also smart. They say the distribution is exactly the same as the PMP examination. So much percentage from so many. Sorry, actually, question distribution is not only based on the process groups. It's also there's something called difficulty level, and all these things you do. So that is how basically you can prepare with whatever time you have for the examination. Sorry, actually I got into this discussion when we are discussing the actual application, but I hope this was useful. So if you have any questions on this particular part, we can do it after we have discussed the PMP exam application. For those of you who joined late, we are going through an entire exam application of one person, Yogasmita, so that all of you get an idea about how to frame your application, so that the chances of your application getting selected for audit is less, and also the review does not come back asking you to update even more, so that your approval takes a longer time. So professional education is cool. So
I will tell one more thing.
Professional education, as I said, yes, basically not just your 35 contact hours of PMP, it could be of any training you have taken, bits and pieces, a credit course that you have taken in your higher studies, out of which 1 or 2 hours you can also call it as project management education. So this is basically, in the past they used to call it as project management education.
I just wanted to say that from Simply Learn, the course will complete, I think, on 26th of September. But I think I will go ahead and file this by today.
Tell me, your Simply Learn course, it is an instructor-led course or a self-paced course?
It is an instructor-led course.
Ah, okay. That's why you have a time. Okay, no issues. You can do that. Just be prepared if your application goes for audit. Right,
but by that time I think already my course certificate would have come, because it is 26th and we are 1 week only away from that.
Just be a bit careful. There is no clear answer to this question. Some people have asked, Bhuvan, fine, today I don't have the certificate, but even when it comes back from an audit, that time I would have the certificate ready. The question is, what if PMI says, yes, but the day on which you submitted your application, you did not have a certificate. So basically, you submitted your application even without finishing your 35 hours. No, PMI will not see that. So your situation, see, on the day your exam application gets accepted, which is either without an audit or after you have cleared an audit, that time you must have your certificate ready. Of course.
Okay.
If today your application goes and it comes back as an audit or something,
usually how many days we have for that to answer back to PMI?
I guess 90 days or 40 days. I'm not sure. Can someone in the group answer? Anyone else has an answer?
Quite a good number.
Yeah. Does anyone have an answer, guys?
Hello?
Am I audible to others?
Anyone?
Hello? Let me pick.
But we don't have answers, so we are.
So, yeah, there is one person also called My Indian Biryani. That's very nice. So I hope I'm audible to everyone. Okay. So yeah, I guess I remember it is like 90 days. I think you'll have. But in your whenever you are getting that mail itself, it will state the deadline by which you have to respond to this. Beautiful.
So, and whatever is your PMP certification 2018, that was automatically, I think it took it. So that is the same this one, right? I mean,
you had to confirm
certification.
From where did it take? You would have entered this, right?
Yeah, but otherwise, I will just check this again.
Try to go to Edit Education, find out. Be very careful. Be aware of every full stop, comma you put in your application. Be very aware what you are putting, because these are they are also come under ethics. And if PMI, see, sometimes there are many people whose applications have gone for audit and they have not submitted their application. It just makes you ineligible to write the PMP examination for, I think, another 1 year. That was the system. So failure to submit the needed data does not disqualify you from writing the exam forever, but you cannot apply for the examination again within a defined time. Right, so be very careful of that. So maybe we can go to the next one. This comes here. We have the experience summary. Does anyone have a question here about professional education part? Anyone else on this particular?
I just had one question on the same lines. I don't know, in between my call dropped, so I just had the question.
the tips or the professional education, no, with respect to PMP. I am also doing this from the Simply Learn, but then the course is there until next month, first week of next month.
It's going instructor to led. Is it instructor led?
Yeah. Sorry, that Simply Learn from the PMP course.
I know, but Simply Learn has two kinds of things. One is self-paced, where you can even take everything and finish in one day, if you sit 24 hours.
Yeah, it is a combination. It has both self-paced as well as the instructor-led. So the live classes, it's coming up to until next month. So can I continue with the application and then submit? Or if in case of audit, will they ask for the proof of this?
Yes. If your application goes for audit, you need to give a proof, a certificate that says that you're indeed finished this. But of course, when that audit email comes to you, your course is still running, you can wait till your course gets over and then you can submit it. Within, as long as it's within the period that PMI gives you to respond to the audit.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Fine. Okay. And since I'm also from Bosch, right? So I just did this. There is other trainings, no, which happens for L1, PMQ, and other kind of.
Yeah. Only one thing. Bosch or any organization, if you are going to claim. Right. I attended this. I told you right a little bit sometime back that the bits and pieces training you can also pick and choose. Generally, even when it goes for an audit, PMI accepts if you just give the attendance certificate. It does not have to be officially stamped by the HR. But believe me, it depends on your organization, because if PMI indeed wants to verify from your organization, generally it will not, but if it does verify your organization and your HR or whoever has to this thing, they cannot vouch for it, then you will be in trouble. And some certificate trainings in certificates should go through HRL TD, HR training and department development. So be very careful, because the so-called PMQ level 1, level 2 trainings and everything, HR has to issue the certificate, and there are some restrictions under which that maybe we can separately also discuss. I can explain to you how you cannot directly claim those hours.
Okay. So the short question. So now, would you recommend for me to go ahead and submit this application, since it's already running out of time, and maybe if it goes for audit, then I can wait and submit.
You can take a chance. You can take a chance. Yes.
You can take a chance.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Because your course will be over when in another 2 weeks, maybe 3 weeks.
Yeah, three weeks.
Only thing is, your review application review takes at least 5 days or something, so till the end of this week. And if your application does get selected for an audit, you will have the time clock starting from the end of this week, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Or end of the coming week. So 2 weeks within that or 3 weeks within that should, but then you have everything else ready. So this certification alone you can attach, and then you can complete the audit.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
That's the recommendation. And one thing, recommendation is, please hurry up, all of you, with your exam applications, because centers are not getting this. And for Coimbatore and also the so-called non-metro regions like Bangalore or Chennai, we are, at least from Bosch, we are in touch with PMI. And I wrote a mail to PMI India also, to the marketing, the head marketing, actually, I also returned to them, requesting for a review of the exam centers, because in Cochin, Rajagiri is not yet open. Vellore VIT is not yet open. Coimbatore, KCT, and many centers, they're not yet open, but they're all listed as centers. And the exam centers are either not as many centers are available as needed in all the regions, and even the few centers that are not open. Well, be very careful. This is a warning. Please be very careful to everyone. Please take account of this. Exam centers are appearing as available on the PMI site. When you go to your PM, when you got eligibility, 1 year eligibility to write the examination, you will go to My PMI, click there, it will take you to PSN View portal, where you can choose the exam center, the city and the center and the date and the time and everything, right? So there, it shows as available and it accepts your application, but then the centers are not open. In fact, I am registered for some other PSN View exam also. And at least 3 times, and also for ACP examination, I tried registering. Already I got 3 times mail from Pearson View, your exam center is not open, we are postponing. But even today when I check, the center is accepting slots. So be very, very, very careful. Just because your PMI/Pearson View site shows the center is available does not mean it is available. You call them. The numbers are given there. You call that center, confirm with them if they are really open. Because I made this check for at least 5 centers across South India and I got the same answer, they are not open. But all the centers are available for booking. So, and they don't have a clue when it will be open again. So be very careful. So my recommendation is apply for the examination immediately so that at least you can start scouting for centers as and when they become available. Otherwise, after December 31st, yes, centers will be available if you are ready to write the examination in the new pattern. Some of you also asked this question. Bhuvan, I have eligibility extended and everything, I can write next year. So can I write in the old pattern? No. Your eligibility means up to 31st December in the old pattern, after that in the new pattern. No excuses. Unless PMI comes up now at the last moment extending, which is highly unlikely, we don't know, extending the validity of the old pattern. So please apply for the exam ASAP. So now we go to the experience summary part of it. Assuming no more questions at this moment, we can also discuss it after this segment. So basically, Yogesh, can you do one thing? Can you tell me after this, what else is there after the experience summary? Can you scroll down?
After this, there is exam details where it says, this address. Okay, I just put address, whatever is there, my house address as per the passport or one of the ID cards.
Information. Okay, and that's it. Can you come down? So there's only one thing that you have to fill, right? The details, experience summary.
Yes. Here, experience summary, yes. And then here, exam location, where, and then request exam accommodations. I will say no.
Okay.
And then agree.
Once you agree and click yes, your application goes.
Yeah, here down you can see that button is there, that submit application. Wow, that gets activated if I... Yes, it's very simple. That's how I have seen people, sitting for weeks together to fill up an application. And
I had my own exam tracker or exam split template. And I had to calculate the hours or non-overlapping experience, and I had to write it exactly initiating, planning, and I spent quite a lot of it. It was a project in itself. So now it's very simple. So you just have to, and one thing, the rules, guys, about your non-overlapping experience still remains. That means, see, for example, you are giving, say, 4,500 hours of experience over 3 years. Imagine from today, you date back to 3 years, say to September 2017 onwards, you're giving your experience. You have worked in two or three different companies in these 3 years. It's okay. And in one company, you are working across multiple projects. You can name those projects, but if two projects you have worked at the same time, right, if you're going to give them, PMI will consider only one of them. That means non-overlapping experience. So different companies you can mention, different projects in the same company you can mention, but just because you're adding, say, at the same time, for example, from April 2018 till December 2018, you have worked in those 7, 8 months, 9 months period. You have worked across 3 projects. If you say, you know what, I worked at the same time, I worked across, say, 1 week here, 1 week there, and everything. You cannot actually add 3 projects multiplied by 9 months, whatever hours. You can't. Only 9 months period is considered. That's it. So you can. At any given time, if there are overlapping experience, it is counted only once. You can work on multiple projects at the same time, but you cannot add the hours of those projects if you are showing overlapping hours. So that's the idea. So that is it to, for example, for the months. And does it ask for months or for 4,500 hours?
I think it calculates by itself time spent on project to date. So I put since Feb 2014 and in
that
progress.
That is 80 months. The total accepted is 36 months. Probably that is a minimum requirement. It says 36 months.
Yes, it did the same here for the same year. So contact hours is 35. I put 48 there. And I just was reviewing here also, Bhuvan, the professional education, it gives course title. And it just allows us to put whatever we want. And I put here based on what Simply Learn mentions on the top. Mm-hmm. Okay. I don't know why it mentions that as PMP you know, copyrighted certification 2018.
Maybe most probably it's in the drop. See, people who already have PMP, they will know it. When you're claiming volunteering hours or PDOs, right? When you're claiming PDOs, that time there's a drop down where the Simplyland is a registered education provider. So in the You can choose the REP and also you can choose the course. So on the PMI portal, right, the so-called CCRS, Continuing Certification Requirement System portal, basically on the database, SimplyLearn is registered as an REP, and all the courses that SimplyLearn offers, which are eligible for contact hours or for PDUs after you are a PMP, a certified person, all these things are also there, probably. So when you select something, it automatically takes the already available thing from the database, the Simply Learns course. Could be. But I think you can change it. You can ignore whatever is there and you can give your own certificate.
What could I write? What could I write?
You have the course. Simply Learn your the course name, right? Use it.
Yeah, that is nothing but PMP certification 2018. So I was thinking that it is some model 2018. So since
it has taken somewhere automatically. You can try to edit the education and you can actually type it. It's not a problem. Just make sure 35 hours you can vouch for it if and when needed. That's all. Okay. And go to experience.
Yeah.
Again, so the application is, I hope for everyone, you're not bored that we are discussing just one application, because I'm also giving you, as you see in the last 1 hour, I also given you various tips, not only about your application, but also how to prepare for the examination. So, because I just don't want you to go back home empty handed after this 1.5 hour, hours. So, can you click somewhere that shows the entire paragraph in one, for example, without scrolling or something like that? Edit, maybe.
Edit here edit experience, it will not, because it's a PDF, right?
Word document, right?
So it will not allow me to do that.
Okay, no problem. So I will give you some tips actually. So what is the character limit? How many? 1500?
One second. I have logged in on the
minimum 100.
Sorry?
It should be minimum 100.
Minimum and maximum?
Maximum
500.
500, not 1000. Okay.
Yeah, 200 to 500, I guess.
See, that's the trick. So your chances of the chances of your application coming back after 5 days of review, asking you to correct this or correct that, becomes very high if you don't use these 500 words, 500 characters or 500 words judiciously.
So 500 should be used, or the minimum can be
minimum. That's the meaning of minimum.
Minimum is fine, right? Okay.
But why do you want to stop with minimum? Use the maximum 500 or something, right? Use that judiciously. I'll give you some tips, because believe me, recently not recently, 1 year back, I did my ACP exam application. My exam is still not written. So when I wrote that, I had this 500, I think, character limit or something. Whatever way I tried to do it,
I could not fit in my
experience in 500 words. Believe me, not my experience, but my agile work experience. And finally, what I did is I hit upon, see, there are lots of internet pages, actually, Google, right? If you Google, you will find tips how to write your experience for a PMP examination or something. And one tip is make a mind map. Don't do it on your computer. Take a piece of pen, take a paper and a pen, a mind map. You put it in a very high level thing. First of all, you don't have to name the company in the description, because it's already there in the organization part. So you save words and try to use abbreviations as much as possible, except for the first time where you write the full form and then in bracket you write the abbreviation, and after which you can use all the abbreviations. Do not put proprietary thing, name of the OEM. OEM you can put tier 1, tier 2. You should never ever Use the customer's name. It's proprietary. Never.
And many organizations
will straight away refuse to vouch the application. In fact, you will be penalized for it. So that's one. Don't give the name of your customer. And how you can make... You have maximum 500 words, for example, right?
Use it.
Plan it. Always put some high-level points. First thing is one line, and only one line, with as few words as possible, you explain what is the nature of your project. This project was software development, for developing some embedded automobile automotive system, for example, something like that. See, don't be too deep. They're not very interested in knowing what latest. If you think you are working in cutting edge automobile technology, blockchain, IoT, they're not interested. Sorry.
So don't
try to explain the technology of your project. Just write one line at a high level. What is it? What industry it is? Automobile, telecommunication, construction, manufacturing, oil and gas, whatever it is. What domain? Say embedded domain, IT or construction or, for example, whatever.
Explain
at high level, is it a software development or production or manufacturing or what, teaching, e-learning or whatever. So try to make it in such a way, in one sentence, you explain the industry, the domain, the nature of the project. That's it. Second, your project does not mean you are doing the project entirely yourself. It is the project inside which you are working. And for each project, you have to have one separate thing. But overall, I think you cannot add more than one project, right?
You can.
I think we end up adding more than one if we want to, you know, gather that 36 months.
Exactly. If you're not working in a project enough time or something, you may have to. So the idea is across all these descriptions, it is 500 words, I believe.
Not just.
Yes, it is 200 to 500, yeah. And I just noticed that I have put only 108.
Then you have to write. Now I understand why you are targeting the minimum. No, target the maximum. Please.
Yeah.
Because the lesser and lesser information you give, the more and more doubts. So I'm not talking about suspicion, but doubts you're creating in the mind of PMI. So it will say, okay, let me see more. Give me more information. Another 5 days. Like that. And if it gets really frustrated, they'll say, okay, accept it and then go for audit. So please use 500 words, right? Use it judiciously. Use that. And so one line will be for the project in which you are working, and second line could be for what is your role in the project. You are the project manager, you are a programmer. See, project management doesn't mean project leadership alone. You need not be the project manager to get project management experience. You can be a junior developer who took part in supporting your project manager in making a project management plan, a requirements plan, or in tracking, or in executing, controlling, closing, or whatever, it could be anything. So second line could be about what your role is in the team, what you did, not your designation, but what you did in that project. So first line talks about what the project is, second line talks about what you did in the project, and third line is more and more in information. For example, what you did as part of this project and everything. So, and always ensure, though we don't have any more split up of the project in the initiating, planning, executing, blah, 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 you still can tailor it accordingly. You would not participate for this particular project in initiating or closing, fair enough, it's okay. But did you take part in planning? Did you give inputs? Don't embellish or exaggerate, but also don't be too modest. Remember, you gave some critical inputs to making your project management plan. You don't have to go to one extent saying, I was responsible for making the project management plan, though I'm not the project manager. And then really, what the project manager was doing? That question will come. You also don't have to understate it. Okay. So you can write us, for example, what inputs you gave. So you said you were involved in providing customer specific
requirements
inputs to the project management plan. So this basically inputs to your scope management plan, subsidiary plan, right? Of your entire PM plan.
Or for your
collect requirements phase. So you are giving inputs. So how you, what inputs were you involved in providing if you are not making the planning itself? So in executing, what did you execute? For example, developing the modules is also project management. Execution of the project is also project management, right? Not only planning or initiating. So one or two lines about this thing. And then you can also talk about monitoring and controlling. You don't say you took part in stand-up meetings. Every day, you know what, I used to just, why the heck am I standing in this meeting? I went and stood in the meeting for 5-10 minutes every day. No, don't write in that way. Don't say that you took part in something. Say that you are actively responsible for tracking of the project. See, your own work, you are tracking. You're not tracking your team members' work. That's also okay. It's also perfectly okay. So you can say, for example, monitoring and controlling, you are responsible for creation of status report trackers. Imagine your project manager comes and asks you. I'm talking about this, assuming some of you may not be project managers. Say for example, I was responsible for creating the status reports, for example, for my manager, something like that. But most of you are already project managers, leading some projects in some capability or other. So talk about what you did concretely. Don't talk about contributed or participated in. Talk about what really you created. Did you create some process, some template? Did you enter some data in a template? Did you present to the management, to any stakeholder? Write proactively. I did this. Don't write in passive voice. Write in active voice. A few sentences. And you will realize by the time you write a sentence, you have exceeded 500 words. Touching 500 words is not a difficulty if you're really done. Because I will tell you, if you understand what I'm going to tell you next, you will understand why this section is needed in the application. PMP exam is not just another certification where people put one more certification, make it. See, anybody can memorize by rote and then they can clear the examination. Believe me, I can take, I'm not making a big claim. Someone who has basic work experience but not real project management experience, you or a union office can take that person, prepare them for solid 3 weeks and make them clear the examination with above target in all areas. I'm not joking, that's the truth. PMP wants to ensure that it's not just another certification people memorize and write, rather it has real value. And real value is only if the people writing the examination already have a value to bring in. Don't think because you are getting a PMP certification, you get value added. You're also adding value to PMP examination itself by being a PMP credential holder. Tell me, why do you want to write PMP? Because it's highly valuable. How did it become highly valuable? Because that certification is being held by people who are actually very well documented practitioners of project management. So PMP certification, not only PMP certification gives you value, you add value to the PMP certification by getting the certification. So I expect you to bring that value by being experienced already. You're not some Tom, Dick and Harry, someone whose only job is sitting and writing examinations. You have enough money and everything. You keep writing the examinations and getting certification. No, PMP says, hey, for example, say Yogasmita, you are getting a certification. No, PMP's value is a little bit higher than yesterday because today you cleared the examination. So PMP wants you to be really qualified to write the PMP examination. So you remember that when you are writing your application, right? So that is why you have to write proactively in an active voice, not in a passive voice. I, as project manager, was responsible for and I did status reporting with so many risk reporting, risk tracking I was responsible for. Go through all the 10 knowledge areas. What was the scope? Did you do something in scope? Did you do something in defining the schedule? Did you take part in budgeting? Did you take part in setting the quality standards, which is quality assurance, or in tracking the quality, which is quality control? Did you take part in identifying the risks, in documenting the risks, in monitoring the risks, in responding to the risks, in defining risk response plans? Did you take part with vendors, procurement management? What exactly did you do? So this, you look at the 10 knowledge areas. As you go into depth in this segment, right, project description, you go through each of, this is what I did, each of the 10 knowledge areas and the 5 process groups, see if you have done something. The matrix you draw again, initiating, planning, monitoring, controlling, executing, closing, and then integration or scope all the way up to procurement. What did you do in this? You are going to name only one project or two projects. In each of these two or three projects or one project, what did you do in that knowledge area and that process group? You write down, you scribble down some notes, convert that into sentences. Then you will realize how much you have actually done as a project manager. You'll be thinking before writing the application, you think, I did not do much project management. You realize already you did. This gives you confidence also for the examination. So now you understood how to write this project description. Start with one line description of what your project is. One more line of what is your role, not designation, but your role in the project. Then the matrix, 5 process groups times 10 knowledge areas. What did you do? For example, in active voice, and then you write, you will be exceeding 500 words. Then pick and choose what you don't want to miss. So only after you have finished what you don't want to miss, if you have still some words left, you can write other things. So prioritize. This sort of an agile planning, right? Prioritized backlog. So you do this. So this is how you write, and then you revise. So get more than 500 words, then cut down what is unnecessary things and everything, and finally you arrive at this 500 words. Project budget, $1 million to $5 million is be very careful when you write such things. No,
that is a good proof. It's okay.
Proof for what?
Overall project which the budget is.
Were you responsible for handling the entire 5 million?
Yes.
Okay, fine.
Then in that case, it's okay. If not, be very careful because that project, it may be a program as well. And your project may be one part of that handles only 1 million. And in that, you are not handling the entire 1 million.
No. It actually, this is a program. Can I write it as issue will become a program, right, Bhuvan?
Don't write program. Project is good enough. I know this question also comes up. Let's not nitpick on program and project. For the sake of PMP, which is a project management professional, write as a project itself.
Yes, of course, in terms of Bosch and in terms of role, it's a issue program manager, but I don't want to bring that flavor in here, as you said.
That's a designation.
Yeah, that is true. Yeah. So, but of course, finally, it's a project itself. And so.
Don't bring in your designations. Yeah. Bring in only your roles and responsibilities.
Yes,
I'm not
exactly
able to see the entire thing, but you said 108 words, right? So my
recommendation. Yeah. Hardly another 2-3. I just finished it within 1 or 2 minutes. So
target 550 words minimum. 500
yeah,
minimum,
I will
right?
do that.
Target 550
I'll
words.
And
one tip I'll give you from my experience. Do it on Word. Only 1 minute. You write it on MS Word. So first thing is at writing the first 1 or 2 or 3 sentences, you now are going to go to the matrix, writing each process group and knowledge area, right? So that when you're writing, write it in Word and then prioritize it. Once you have written down on the piece of pen, paper and pen, you've written down in each process group and knowledge area, you prioritize what you don't want to miss, not what you want to say, but what you don't want to miss. And pick the top 5 I don't want to miss. No, Moscow. Must have. So you do that. You already see you are exceeding 500. So write it on a MS Word. So that then and there, because there's no use. You think so much mental energy, spiritual energy you put in writing everything, only to find that your 1,000 words you've written, and then it becomes another project. So don't save your energy. Write it on MS Word, the do not miss parts. Then, if you still have some words, write. But most of the time, by the time you write your do not miss words, you have exceeded 500. Then try to cut short on that 500 in rephrasing and everything. Don't try to bring every point. Whatever points you are giving, make sure that you are documenting it clearly so that they will agree that you have the real spirit of the PM experience, not just the letter of the experience.
Yeah, sorry, someone was asking.
Yeah, Bhuvan, actually here the project date is mentioned as February 2014 to in progress.
Mm-hmm.
So that means the project is running for a very long time. Usually any project should have a definite start and end date, right? So if you are going to put like February 2014 to in progress, they may assume this is an operational topic.
Beautiful. Now you understand why Yogasmita, I wanted you to bring it into this forum rather than doing a one-to-one review of this. Beautiful. That's a very good question. In the earlier days, when you had initiating planning and all those split, right, there you could split your entire project as into this segment, and you can always say some of those segments ended. So the idea is, it says to date. Does it allow you to make in progress the application? If the answer is yes, then it should not be a problem.
I'm just checking it.
Did you put it as open-ended or the... Yeah, check that. That's a very valid question.
It allows someone.
Actually, like I filled my application. I submitted the application as well. It got selected without any audit. So, mm-hmm. like, actually, there I have given a lot of projects, close to some 8 to 9 projects with the start and end date. And fortunately, like, December 2018 is the last project I have given. And when I try to add more projects, it says, like, no more project is needed. So, like, it already filled this status. So, like, it did not allow me to enter more project. And as you told, like, I have given that initiation planning, each and every phase, like, what is that particular topic, what are the particular topic I have handled. So, like, I have given a very clear description of what I have worked.
Mm-hmm.
So, maybe that might be the one reason, like, I feel that my application was not selected for. audit. Could be. But actually, I suspect here, like February 2014 to in progress, and also the team size 15 to 19, and
we'll raise red flag. We'll raise red flag.
A little bit skeptical, yeah.
We'll raise red flag.
Yes. Meanwhile,
why team size is a problem?
Sorry.
Why team size should be a problem?
Project that runs for more than six years, right? Still not finished. Running with 19 people, right? This combination
will
raise a red flag.
Okay.
Likely to raise red flag. So see, actually, if you can split it as, see, you are not, don't give a global thing, right? I'm handling ECU complete ECU. Talk of maybe one particular thing alone. See, they're not interested in knowing your entire career experience. You're not attending a job interview or you're not applying for a job. So can you narrow it down to one particular? See, in 6 years, many projects would have come in this program. So don't, what you are mentioning here is a program in the name of a project. So can you limit to one or two projects into this program, and only that you can give? That's better. One of them can be still in progress. The latest one can be still be in progress. But as you write, who was that? Sorry, point out rightly. February 2014 to today in progress. Sorry, it does not look like a
project one.
Sorry? Vijay, yes. Thanks, Vijay. Yeah, this is a very valid red flag.
Yes.
So my recommendation is, take up from your so-called program, right, ECU program in double quotes, you take up projects. Definitely you would have delivered some versions of the ECU, some software, some hardware, some parts and everything, right? Take up only that. Maybe take up two, maximum three projects. One of them could be still in progress. You need not have the in progress project also in this list. It's okay. Try to present it. And totally find it words. But when you do more than one project, you have to be careful about the word limit.
Okay.
Bhuvan, sorry to interrupt.
Yes.
About the budget as well as the team size, we also get an option to put it as classified, meaning we don't prefer to...
You have it? Then please.
Share that.
Then
we can do, right?
Then use it. If the drop down, if the application allows you to mention something, use it.
Because
I'll tell you, I'm just giving you tips how to avoid red flags. As you rightly said, when you have a classified option and instead you don't use it and you use 1 to 5 million, together 50 to 19 people working on a 6.5 year project which is still in progress and you are a senior project manager, 5 million, sorry, actually...
Individually, they may not be red flags,
but as a combination, surely there is going to be a red flag.
More probable.
So my recommendation is.
Yeah, if it is for a program, probably it makes sense. Yes. If it's for a project.
It's a project management professional. It's not a program management professional.
Yeah.
So try to take one project, one version of the ECU delivered, maybe two, and right within the last 3 years, whatever you delivered, right, do that, use it. Experience better. Let it be, if possible, mention what you did in the last 3 years from today.
That's the recommendation.
That's the recommendation.
The team size is also classified available.
Yeah, but don't
put too many classifiers again.
See,
there's no hard and fast rule.
Too many classifiers
you put also that raises, I'm just saying, please be very careful. It's pick and choose. Reduce as many red flags as possible on a case by case basis.
So these are some tips actually,
and I think the rest of them are just basic information, personal information. So does anyone have questions or comments from your own experience, having already submitted your PMP application? We have 10 more minutes.
So, last month, actually, I have completed one project. Mm-hmm. I mean, 35 colleagues were there. But, I don't want to create a red flag there, as you told. So, I given 5 to 9. So, because fair enough, I worked, I know. But, I don't want to create some kind of red flag, as you told. So, that is the reason I try to reduce. So, we are not lying anything there. But, as per the code of ethics, we are following it. But just I'm reducing to avoid the red flags, as you said. So this is my
tips. Point. Actually, there is no hard and fast rule. This is same like asking what's the pass mark in PMP examination. There is no clearly defined. Yeah, some people claim say 70%, 60%, all this. See, this is all just anecdotal information. There is no hard and fast proof that this is a pass mark. This will ensure your application is not audited. No, there is nothing. And if anyone claims, I'm very sorry, I actually don't believe. If anyone claims in the affirmative, they know how to get a PMP thing in.
Loan, what is the next test date?
Next?
Test date. PMP test date.
24/7. 24/7. Who was this? Shankar, there is no. Okay, PMP, it's not a fixed date. If you're taking the.
Actually, I have written paper mode. I have written, that is why.
Oh, okay. I have never seen anyone take in paper mode. Why do you want to take in paper mode?
No, last time when I have applied, I have given for paper mode.
You can change it, right? Why do you want to take a paper mode?
So I can change it now.
So talk to PMI. Write to PMI. Surely you have email addresses. Write to PMI request them to take computer-based. See, computer-based, if it's test center, I think from 9 o'clock or 8:30 in the morning, there are lots of slots, 4-hour slots, or I think 4.5-hour slot or something it gives you. Proctored examination, I think, more flexible because you're taking from home and so you have more slots available.
Okay.
Yeah,
I think I have applied for Bhuvaneswar. I don't know whether it is possible or not in this corona.
It's test, computer-based test itself, they're not opening. For paper-based test, they will not easily open. Paper-based test is even more contact.
Okay.
Please, sir.
Now, which mode I have to shift now?
It's basically test center-based. Either that or you should think you can confidently take from home with reliable power supply and internet connection, make a proctored exam. Speak to them.
Okay, then actually internet also is a problematic.
Can you take it from there? Yeah, because there's not much difference between paper-based, the risk is the same.
Yeah.
So, good.
Bhuvan, actually, there's a plan to set up an exam center in a boss office, right?
Is that quick information, that's a non-starter. Yes, we tried everything. I was basically involved. I was basically involved with, Satish, with a couple of people. We tried. What we basically did was we procured a couple of laptops from IT. We tried to set up the firewall and everything in a way that does not reject. You know, you have to do the OnView software from Pearson View. That OnView software you to install. Firewall and everything, we are able to get some restrictions removed, but somehow it's still not completely done, and that's not gone anywhere. So that's a problem. Actually, your personal laptop, it doesn't have a firewall, but your office laptop has a firewall, and all these tests and everything. And believe me, because of technical issues, if your exam gets interrupted, PMI will count it as one attempt gone. Or it could be because of the software firewall, it could be because of internet connection gone, power supply, anything, right? You are responsible for it. In fact, we are requesting PMI now also to give a leeway because of power supply and everything, because centers are not simply opening up, and people are getting tense because exam, the 31st December is approaching. So we are requesting that. Unless it is a malpractice that people suspect and the exam gets over, PMI should ideally give some of the same attempts. Because in India, to be very honest, how much you would love to wish our system is good and everything, power supply is unreliable. Yes, for example, recently I also got an inverter at home, but that does not mean I have two Wi-Fi's now. Still, I will not confidently take exam at home. Because our system is not built for this kind of reliability that PMI expects for a PMP examination or any examination.
That's a problem.
And of course, all these things, you have to inform your family not to walk, you have to take a room inside a room, you have to take the exam, you have to inform your family not to make a noise. All these things, the stress of the PMP examination itself is good enough. Why do you take additional stress? Let the center handle it.
Very true.
That used to be my statement till recently, but now slowly when I keep hearing from people, we are not getting centers, and people say, hey, Bhuvan, my application, my schedule was accepted, but then when I call the center, they are not open. When I hear such stories, I'm wondering, is the risk really worth? Yes, it looks like the take from home risk is actually worth, because the alternative is waiting forever for the exam center. Or worse, your exam center accepts your application on the day of the examination, it turns back. In fact, I told you, at least three notifications I got from Pearson, you postponing my examination. By default, they postponed by 1 month and then give you the time to reschedule it. But to where? To when? We don't know. And if you are going to an exam center, all these quarantine rules and everything apply. And we don't want a situation you are made to go 14 days before self-quarantine and all these stupid things. Yeah, so these are not good times for taking the test from a test center. But the question is, you're all writing a project management professional to become project managers to handle a project. So that means it's also a decision that you're taking. In risk management, you know this, right? Expected monetary value. So you see the costs and benefits. So it is your call, actually. So this is how smartly, what are the parameters you use to take a decision, how long you take to make a decision, and how you stick with the decision, and what is the flexibility you give yourself to managing the consequences of the decision. So this is, you're a project manager, so you have to take a call. Good, good. So I think we are clear about how to write a PMP exam application. Some tips and tricks, what to do, what not to do, how to avoid red flags to reduce, not eliminate, but reduce the probability of your application either coming back with more corrections or going for an audit and all those things. Despite doing all these things, your application will still be selected for an audit. There's no guarantee. It can still be selected for an audit. But then at least reducing the probability is something we can do and we should do. So you have any other questions about preparing for the examination or the generic tips, how to pace yourself? You can use a tracker, actually. I'm very much thankful for, say, Rachel, for that conversation which triggered me into cleaning up the tracker and creating that thing. And thanks a lot. And I know confusions are really big time when it comes now towards the last. So please make sure you don't give in to unnecessary confusions. That's why planning really helps. So planning helps avoid these confusions, sharpening the axe. So you are getting certified to be a project manager. So be a project manager already. Plan properly. You have 3 months, 2 months, 1 month, 3 weeks, doesn't matter. You can always have a plan. You have a 3 month project, you can plan for 1 week. You have a 3 week project, you can always plan for 1 day. It's always possible. Please do that. One moment.
Yeah.
So there is no
actually planning.
Okay. Sorry. One moment. So what I do is I share my screen again very quickly. So any other last questions you guys have?
Anyone?
Hello? Am I still audible?
Yeah. None from my side, Bhuvan. Thanks a lot, Yoga Smita here. And thanks others also for your inputs. I'm already hooked on to this application now because I have a target to submit it today.
Okay.
Yeah, thanks.
No issues. Welcome. So good. So any other last questions on any PMP topics? Did anyone of you come up with questions from some knowledge area before we close?
One question, Bhuvan.
Yes.
Actually, like for the professional and social responsibility, that is not part of any of the project process group. Right?
Yes.
So, like, whether any questions will be there from professional and social responsibility.
I'll tell you, professional PMI ethics and social responsibility is not a separate one. Of course, there's a separate chapter section for it in PMBOK, but these questions will not. Okay, sometimes they'll come as ethics questions, true, but most of the time they'll be disguised as decision making questions. What will you do in a situation within knowledge areas? For example, they will ask you a question that helps you make a calculation or make some analysis based on some knowledge area. And then what do you do? One example I'll give you. Imagine it's a cost management slash schedule management question. They give you some data that makes you calculate the critical path. And then you find that you are delayed. Okay. You calculate the critical path and everything. And then you find that one of the activities is likely to get delayed. And critical path, your float is zero. So you cannot afford any delays on your critical path. Now, you also say your budget is given, cost management, you're given a budget and everything. And you find that unless you get extra money, you cannot fast track the project,
for example, or crash
the project by putting more resources, and your management has clearly refused you money. And schedule management part is where you calculated the schedule and everything. You track the schedule, you are finding you are delayed. Cost management part is you know the budget and you know how much budget you have, and you know how much money you also need to
make the project go faster,
and you don't have the money. So you already did some analysis in schedule management, cost management based on the information given. Now the question that will come now is, what will you do in the situation?
Four
options. One of the options could be, you since you're not able to get that extra budget from the management, ask your team members to come and work overtime without paying, without being paid.
Another question.
Yes, you
make the project
team members work
the project, but ask them not to book any timesheet. Book any
timesheet. Imagine these are actually not decisions you can straight away make from your calculations. These are ethics questions. Can you make your team members work without accounting for it?
No.
Why? It's PMI ethics. You cannot see, because your management wants to save money and has refused to money. Additional budget. Because your customer wants to save money and genuinely,
it's a genuine change request.
Genuinely somebody has to work on it. Things have to be done. But if your customer refuses to pay money for it, genuinely your management should give money, but they're not giving. You cannot actually make your team members work overtime without getting paid. That's unethical.
Now
you tell me this is a professional responsibility question, or is it a stakeholder management or a cost management question? It's everything, right? So this is how ethics questions can come disguised.
But
many times what we do is we look at only the cost management, schedule management, only the 10 knowledge areas. But beyond the 10 knowledge areas and across all the 10 knowledge areas, there are some things, and that is ethics. Just because your PMP, PMBOK says in this knowledge area, take this decision, do this, your process says this, the 49 process, they say this, doesn't mean you will do that. None of this 49 process can supersede ethics. Ethics supersedes everything.
You cannot
do something unethical. Take money from later contingency reserve. Yes, you can do. That is within yours. That's a good answer. But not asking team members not to book their timesheets, not to book their times is unethical. So what will you do? If contingency reserve is also not enough, you will simply say no.
Of course,
the way you say no will be, you will go back to the PM plan, you'll go back to the schedule management plan, cost management plan, you look at everything, that's your Bible, that's what you wrote yourself, you will see the steps to do, and you will do all the calculations, you will do the change request impact analysis,
change control process, you will give the impact of this
change on the cost, and then you'll find I want this money, and your CCB rejects it, or your sponsor rejects it.
Then
you will say no to the customer.
How you say no?
It can follow the processes.
But you cannot actually blindly accept it
and make team members work unaccounted for. This is an ethics question. So now you understand how ethics questions will come?
Yeah, very much. Thank you.
Sometimes,
nice example one, thank you.
No issues. But sometimes you will get straight away ethics questions also. Simple worded thing. You are being given tickets. See, one thing with ethics, remember one thing, guys. It's not only what you do, what you are perceived
do. Perception
also, is an ethic thing.
For example,
your wife is working for a competitor company. And then, or your best friend. My wife means it gives, for example, other situations where you can discuss with her. Your good friend. You know, your good friend who was working with you as a colleague in your company has resigned and gone to another competitor company. And after some weeks, some months, you meet them, meet him or her in a conference and you discuss. And they say, why don't we go and why don't we discuss about your, what your project you're doing? Straight away, it's unethical to discuss confidential information. But some information you can still discuss without breaking confidentiality. But imagine if a third party sees this and they believe that you are colluding with this person, that perception is also wrong. So with ethics, it need not matter only what you do. Also the perception. You are perceived to be doing something. So certain things you will avoid doing even if they are seemingly ethical in double quotes, you will not do it because the perception, if you are perceived to be unethical, that's also enough, you will not do it. So these are some questions that may come directly. Can you accept IPL tickets?
Some of you are in Dubai.
So IPL starts next week, in less than a week's time in UAE, in Dubai or wherever, right? So you are a project manager and you are offered a VIP box seats. Who offers? Your customer offers. Great. Or your supplier offers, your vendor offers. Great. But believe me, at the same time, you are actually evaluating, selecting vendors. There are two or three vendors and this is one vendor among three and he or she is offering you tickets.
Fine.
Everyone knows you are a very great, what is this called? Can you say a straightforward person? You will not take any. Everyone knows it. But imagine at this time or even after you awarded the contract to this supplier, within
a short time you're taking tickets
from that person and going, how will others perceive it? Yeah, so you should not take tickets. This is another ethics question. So I think now ethics is clear, right?
Yes, Bhavan.
Yeah. Maybe we can do one session. You can all bring up, we can take up some ethics questions and discuss why it's the right answer and why it's the wrong answer. IPL is a project, Rajesh. Yeah, it depends how you take it. Conducting entire IPL is a project because it has all the aspects of a project. But within IPL, cleaning, curating the pitch, generally curating the pitch is a project, setting up the pitch, bringing the right soil, transporting the soil and making a bouncy track or a spinning track or a, how to say, quicksand track, all these things, they may look, the outcome is a project, but every day rolling the pitch, you are paying people. In another 1 week's time, there is a very top thing, Mumbai Indians against Chennai Super Kings. And every day they are sweeping the pitch, cleaning. That's not a project, it's an operation. You understood the difference?
Yeah?
Beautiful. So guys, I'm seeing the time. One last question before we close.
Of course,
for those of you who don't know, please join the WhatsApp group so you get advance information on the sessions that we conduct and also post the session, the videos. This video I'll also post on YouTube. You will get the information. You can also suggest topics for sessions on this WhatsApp group and subscribe to this channel, PM Ratha, because the thanks I see many of you have subscribed. So if you subscribe, you'll get automatic information on the videos. It also be a motivation for me because
can you please tell the WhatsApp group so that we can join there, because I do not know. Can you send it here?
I'm typing here.
Thank you.
On this chat box, I'm typing. It takes some time because.
Yeah, that's okay. Yeah. Thank you.
No problem. One moment. So. Okay.
Done.
Okay, I've typed the link for the WhatsApp group and also the channel. So it will also motivate me when I see more and more people subscribing to the channel or join the WhatsApp group. It's motivation for me. So good. Thanks a lot. I'll type this link. All right. So any one last question?
Or we can close for today.
I hope, Yogasmita, you got the information, your review, and I hope everyone else also got some tips about how to write the application or prepare for the examination.
Yes, one last question I had also to the other colleagues who are also online here. When we make this 36 months for the experience, should it end to the date where we are, or the last most experience, should it be in progress? Or
need not be.
So I can always make 2019.
You need not mention what you are working on today. Yes, better if you are going to give a closed project, give it within the last 1 year, na, for safety. Just avoid a red flag.
Actually, what I did is, like when I gave after December 2019, further it did not allow me to add further experience. Like for the past experience, also I'm working as a project manager in some complex project, which I want to add in the application. But it did not allow me, so I left it. And
so then your application will have October 2019 as the last experience.
December 2019, yes.
December 2019. Okay.
Beautiful. Beautiful.
Okay, I'm just adding one or two projects.
It's combination of all this is a red flag. So just take it.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Good. Guys, then thank you everyone for your time and for your support and motivating me. Thanks a lot for the opportunity, and we will meet again next week. Please, in the WhatsApp group, share what topics you want to discuss. I'm speaking to this expert in procurement management, whether he can give a session on, say, type of contracts. We cannot do the entire procurement management. We don't want to do, but we can take only type of contracts or anything. I'm trying to, within the next 2 weeks, we can get this. Like that, if anyone of you wants also to give your own thing, you don't have to pick up the entire knowledge area. Select one particular topic that you learned by yourself, you learned, got some insights. Please feel free to present. It's not only bonus, only presenter. If you want to present, we can facilitate it. Why not? So you learned something and you want to share this excitement with the others, please do that. Yeah? All right.
Okay.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Yes, and have a nice day, and all the best, guys.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Yes, bye.